The deep fascia on the palmar aspect of hand is specialized to form three structures. The first one is the flexor retinaculum, which is present in front of the carpal bones. Next is the palmar aponeurosis. The outline of it is present in front of the metacarpal bones. And last but not the least, in front of the digits, the deep fascia is modified to form the fibrous flexure sheath of the digits. This fibrous flexure sheaths of the digits extend from the head of the metacarpal to the base of distal phalanx. So, flexor retinaculum, palmar aponeurosis, and fibrous flexure sheaths are the three modifications of the deep fascia on the palmar aspect of the hand. Regarding the flexor retinaculum, which is present in front of the carpal bones, it is a strong fibrous rectangular band, which is also known as transverse carpal ligament. So another name of flexor retinaculum is transverse carpal ligament. It is to be noted that the carpal bones are 18 number, and the cross section of the carpal bones, either at the level of proximal row or distal row, cross section on either level will show that carpal bones present a ventral concavity. That is a ventral concavity of the carpal bones. That ventral concavity is bridged by the flexor retinaculum and is converted into an osseofibrous tunnel. And that tunnel is known as the carpal tunnel. The flexor retinaculum is formed due to the thickening of the deep fascia in front of the carpal bones, and the carpal tunnel thus formed is meant for the passage of long flexor tendon of the digits and median nerve, which we will see later on in the discussion. Regarding the attachment of the flexor retinaculum, we have to study the carpal bones from the palmar aspect. that is the palmar view of carpal bones. And you know that the carpal bones are 18 number arranged in two rows. The proximal row contains scaphoid, lunate, triquetral and pisiform, and the distal row contain the trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate. Now, as this is the side of the thumb, this is the lateral side, and the other side will be the medial side. The scaphoid bone presents a tubercle on its lateral side, that is called tubercle of scaphoid, and trapezium presents a bony projection that is called crest of trapezium. So, tubercle of scaphoid and crest of trapezium are the lateral attachments of the flexor retinaculum. On the medial side, we know about the outline of the pisiform bone, which is located or sitting above the triquetrum. And this is the hook of hamate. So pisiform bone and hook of hamate provide the medial attachment of flexor retinaculum. So if we join all these landmarks, let us join it. That means on the medial side, hook of hamate and pisiform, with the lateral side, the crest of trapezium and tubercle of scaphoid, we get the attachment of flexor retinaculum, the medial and lateral attachment of flexor retinaculum. So lateral attachment is on the crest of trapezium and tubercle of scaphoid, medial attachment of hook of hamate and pisiform bone. Regarding the proximal and the distal tracing of the flexor retinaculum, let me show you the pictures. Proximally, the flexor retinaculum is attached with the tendon of palmaris longus, whereas distally, it is continuous with the apex of palmar aponeurosis. So the attachment on the lateral side, on the medial side, and the tracing on both proximally and distally has already been discussed. Now, going on to the additional slips of this flexor retinaculum. If the main fibers of flexor retinaculum are considered, this forms a fibrous bridge over the concavity of the carpal bone. Now this main mass gives a superficial slip on the medial side, and which is attached to the pisiform bone. This is a scaphoid, lunate, triquetral, pisiform from lateral to medial side. This represents a cross section of the proximal row of the carpal bones. CS at the level of proximal row. So that is the superficial slip on the medial slide. Also known as the volar carpal ligament. The ulnar nerve and vessel pass deep to the slip, in between the slip and the main fibers of flexor retinaculum. So ulnar vessel and the ulnar nerve that are passing in the gap between the volar carpal ligament and the flexor retinaculum. Similarly, there is also a deep sleep that is given out from the main band of flexor retinaculum. And that deep sleep is given out on the lateral side. And the deep sleep is attached to the medial lip of the groove of trapezium. Let me show you the groove of trapezium. This is the groove of trapezium. Trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate. The groove of trapezium has a lateral lip and a medial lip. So the deep sleep is attached to the medial lip on the groove of the trapezium and convert it into an osteofibrous tunnel. And through this tunnel, the tendon of flexor carpi radialis is passing. So the flexor carpi radialis tendon is actually passing through it. Let me show you. This is the tendon of This is the tendon of flexor carpi radialis. Passing through the tunnel. Clear? So there are superficial sleep and deep sleep. Superficial sleep is called the volar carpal ligament, given out on the medial side, and deep sleep is given out on the lateral side. That is the deep sleep. And here lies the tendon of flexor carpi radialis. Now we will see the structures that pass superficial to the flexor retinaculum. What are the structures that pass above the flexor retinaculum? If we draw the flexor retinaculum in front of the carpal bones, it looks like a quadrangular postage stamp. If we take the flexor retinaculum in isolation, the quadrangular structure is actually like this. On the lateral side, there is crest of trapezium and the tubercle of scaphoid, and over on the median side, there is the hook of hamate and the pisiform bone. Pisiform and hook of hamate. Structure that pass superficial to the flexor retinaculum are as follows. Structure passing above. The tendon of palmaris longus. That is the tendon of palmaris longus. Okay, so one tendon. Then we get two arteries. What are the two arteries? One is the ulnar artery. Another is the superficial palmar branch of radial artery. This is the radial artery. This is the superficial palmar branch. So one tendon, two artery. And last is, that but not the least, three nerves. So rule of 1, 2, 3. What are the three nerves? The first is the ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve. And as I have already told, that ulnar nerve and ulnar artery, both of them pass through the tunnel between the superficial slip and the main bands of flexor retinaculum. Then ulnar nerve also gives a palmar cutaneous branch of ulnar nerve. This is the palmar cutaneous branch of ulnar nerve. There is another nerve that is coming out of the median nerve, which itself, the median nerve itself passes below the flexor retinaculum, but one branch from the median nerve, that is the palmar cutaneous branch of median nerve, passes above the flexor retinaculum. So we get three nerves, one tendon, two artery, and three nerve. Altogether, how many structures? Six structures. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six structures are passing above the flexor retinaculum. So these six structures are superficial relation to the flexor retinaculum. So what about the structure that are passing deep to the flexor retinaculum? Let's see that. In order to see the structure passing deep to the flexor retinaculum, we have to take a cross section. This is the lateral side, this is the medial side, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, and hamate. So this cross section is taken at the level of the distal row of carpal bones. Now here is the flexor retinaculum. This slip, as you have already known, this is the deep slip of flexor retinaculum given on the lateral side. The structure passing underneath the flexor retinaculum is first the median nerve. Median nerve. It must be noted over here that the ulnar nerve passes above the flexor retinaculum. So ulnar nerve is above. And radial nerve is actually having no relation with the flexor retinaculum. Rather, it passes over the dorsum of the wrist, over the extensor retinaculum. So this is the ulnar nerve. So median nerve is underneath the flexor retinaculum, underneath the flexor retinaculum, and ulnar nerve is above the flexor retinaculum. What other structure are passing below the flexor retinaculum? The four tendons for flexor digitorum superficialis and four tendons of flexor digitorum profundus. Both of these two sets of long flexor tendons are passing below the flexor retinaculum, and both of them are surrounded by a double layered membranous pouch, which is called ulnar bursa. So what is ulnar bursa? Around the tendons of flexor digitorum profundus. These are the flexor digitorum profundus. And these are the flexor digitorum superficialis. As the name suggests, they lie superficial to the profundus tendon. There is a fluid filled double layered synovial pouch. The outer layer of this pouch is lining the carpal tunnel, and this outer layer of this pouch is known as a parietal layer. Whereas the inner layer that lines the tendons themselves and is reflected in between the tendons as well is known as the visceral layer. In between the parietal and visceral layer, there is the presence of synovial fluid. This fluid-filled synovial pouch is called ulnar bursa. This total thing is called ulnar bursa. So ulnar bursa is a double-layered fluid-filled synovial membranous pouch. The fluid is the synovial fluid, and it actually envelops all the long flexor tendons of the medial foot digits. That means tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis and flexor of flexor digitorum profundus. These tendons are enclosed in ulnar bursa. Whereas the tendon of flexor pollicis longus, there is another tendon that is called the tendon of flexor pollicis longus. This tendon of flexor pollicis longus is also surrounded by another double layered bursa that is called the radial bursa. You may be thinking that how the radial bursa have got two layers. In order to understand that, we have to draw the picture in detail. Suppose this is the cut section of the tendon of flexor pollicis longus, and around it is the radial bursa. The radial bursa have an outer layer and an inner layer. And both the layers are continuous. Like this. So this diagram, in closer inspection, will look like this. So this is the parietal layer. This will be the visceral layer, and in between the parietal and visceral layer surrounding the tendon will be the synovial fluid. So it is called the radial bursa. So ulnar bursa surrounds the flexor digitorum superficialis and profundus, but the radial bursa surrounds the tendon of flexor pollicis longus. Apart from all these tendons, there is another tendon that passes through the main band, and its deep slip and the groove of trapezium muscle, and that tendon, you know, is the tendon of flexor carpi radialis. It is also covered by a synovial sheath, but that synovial sheath has no special name. So these are the structure that pass beneath the flexor retinaculum. What are the structure? First of all, the flexor digitorum superficialis, and below it the tendons of flexor digitorum profundus. These tendons in the set of four actually meant for the index, middle, retinal, and ring finger, and for the thumb there is only one set of tendon, that is the tendon of flexor pollicis longus. The FDS and FDP are covered in a synovial pouch that is called ulnar bursa. It is a common synovial pouch, whereas the flexor pollicis longus is covered in radial bursa. And there is another tendon, that is the tendon of flexor carpi radialis, that passes through in the gap between the main fiber of the flexor retinaculum and the lateral deep slip, and is also covered by its own synovial sheath. And along with these tendons and their synovial sheath, the median nerve is passing underneath the flexor retinaculum in the carpal tunnel. So we can also see that all these structures, median nerve, flexor digitorum, superficialis, flexor pollicis longus, flexor carpi radialis, all are passing through the carpal tunnel, right? In case there is an excessive pressure buildup within the carpal tunnel, the first structure that is we going to hit, that is the median nerve. There will be lesion in the median nerve. There will be pressure symptoms on the due to median nerve compression. So if there is any accumulation of fluid or any other pathology that will raise the tension in the carpal tunnel, that will actually result in compression of the median nerve. And it will give rise to a group of symptoms which are collectively known as carpal tunnel syndrome. So carpal tunnel syndrome occurs as a result of compression of median nerve in the carpal tunnel. And in order to relieve the patient from the carpal tunnel syndrome, what we have to do is that we have to surgically cut the flexor retinaculum in order to release the tension of the carpal tunnel and give the patient relief. So that is the arrangement and the structural relationship of the flexor retinaculum. The deep fascia of the palm is seen when the skin over the palm is lifted. Now, before going into the details, let me tell you that at the root of little finger there is a muscular bulge which is called hypothenar eminence. Similar muscular bulge is also seen at the root of the thumb, which is termed thenar eminence. When you lift the skin from the palmar aspect, what you get to see is that remnant of the superficial fascia. And when you clean up the superficial fascia or the deep fibrous tissue, that is the superficial fascia, then you clearly see the deep fascia. Now, the deep fascia of the palm is very thin over the hypothenar eminence. And the thenar eminence. So over both of the eminence there is deep fascia, but that deep fascia is very thin. But in the central part of the palm, the deep fascia is modified to form a thick triangular structure. This is called palmar aponeurosis. The palmar aponeurosis is a strong, well-defined part of the deep fascia of the palm that is located centrally between the thenar and hypothenar eminence, and it covers the long flexor tendons and superficial palmar arch. That means when we lift the palmar aponeurosis, we get to see the structure under cover of palmar aponeurosis. And those structures are nothing but the long flexor tendons. The flexor tendon that are going to be inserted into the digits. Part of them has been shown. And the intervening lumbrical muscles. Okay. And also the superficial palmar arch. You can see there is a U-shaped segment of artery that is called superficial palmar arch. These are the long flexor tendons. So both the long flexor tendon and the superficial palmar arch and associated structures are under the cover of the palmar aponeurosis and can be seen when the palmar aponeurosis is lifted up. Okay. Now the outline of the palmar aponeurosis is triangular. And it's made up of mainly longitudinal fibers and few transverse fiber in between the longitudinal fibers. So these are the longitudinal fibers. Intervening between the longitudinal fibers are the transverse fibers. As it is a triangular, it has an apex. The apex is directed proximally towards the wrist and is blended up with the flexor retinaculum. Whereas the base is directed distally toward the root of the finger. The palmar aponeurosis present the following features: apex, base, medial border, and lateral border. Four parts: apex, base, medial border and lateral border. Regarding the apex, it is the narrow proximal end of the palmar aponeurosis, which is blending with the flexor retinaculum. And its superficial fibers are continuous with the tendon of palmaris longus. Regarding the base, it is the broad distal end of the palmar aponeurosis. Just proximal to the head of metacarpals, the base divides into four longitudinal slips. So the base is dividing into 1, 2, 3, and 4 longitudinal slips. Each slip divide into superficial and deep set of fiber. So each slip has a superficial set and a deep set of fiber. The superficial fiber blend with the dermis of the overlying skin. And the superficial transverse metacarpal ligament. Superficial transverse metacarpal ligament. And the deep set of fibers divide into two bands, which are attached to the deep transverse ligament of the palm. So deep bands, okay, deep set of fiber divided into two bands, 1, 2, clear? The slips you are seeing over here, these are actually the deep slips. You see? These are the deep slips. These four slips. Where is the superficial slip? Actually, the superficial slips have been given off like this. And they have blended with the overlying skin, the dermis of the overlying skin. So that is the superficial slip. Each of the deep slip is divided into two bands. Okay. So two bands of the deep slip are one medial, one lateral band. Medial band, lateral band. Medial band and lateral band. And they are attached to the deep transverse ligament of the palm, palmar ligament of the metacarpophalangeal joint, base of the proximal phalanx, and the most importantly, these two bands are attached to the fibrous flexor sheath of the digits, that is the deep fascia of the digits. So once again, what is happening? The base of the palmar aponeurosis is divided into superficial and deep. So there are four slips. The four slip, each of the four slip, okay, is giving out superficial set and deep set of fibers. The superficial slit set that have been annotated in black that blend with the superficial transverse metacarpal ligament and skin, where the deep set which have been annotated in the red, the deep set, they are each divided into two bands, and ultimately these bands are attached to the bones underneath. What are the bones over these areas? Obviously, the bones which are attached, which are present in this area, are the metacarpophalangeal joints at the root of the fingers, and they, that means these bands of deep sleep, they are attached to the metacarpophalangeal joint, they are attached to the deep transverse ligament, they are attached to the base of the proximal phalanx, and most importantly, they blend with the deep fascia of the digits, that is the fibrous flexure sheaths of the digits. Now, regarding the medial and lateral border, if we see the medial border at first, the medial edge of the aponeurosis is continuous with the deep fascia that goes more medially to cover the hypothenar muscle, and this medial border gives rise to a muscle that is called palmaris brevis. Palmaris brevis. The medial palmar septum and close to it the intermediate palmar septum extend inward from the medial border. So from the medial border, the medial palmar septum is going downwards. So on the cross section of the hand, we can see the cross section of hand is like this. Suppose we take the cross section in this region. The cross section will be looking like this. These are the medial forefingers. This is the thumb. Where is the palmar aponeurosis? This is the palmar aponeurosis. This is the medial border. This is the lateral border. From the medial border, I said, there is a septa that is going down. That is called medial palmar septum. Medial palmar septum. And also close to the medial border, another septum is going downward, that is called intermediate palmar septum. Okay. The lateral border or the lateral edge of the aponeurosis is continuous with the deep fascia that cover the thinner muscle, and lateral palmar septum extend inward from this edge to the first metacarpal. That is the lateral palmar septum extending from the edge of the lateral border inwards. Now these palmar septa are attached to the underlying metacarpal bones. The medial palmar septum is attached to the fifth metacarpal. The intermediate palmar septum to the third metacarpal. And the lateral palmar septa to the first metacarpal bone. What is the function of palmar aponeurosis? First thing, the palmar aponeurosis help to improve the grip of the hand by fixing the skin with the underlying deep fascia. So first function is improve grip. The next one is protect the underlying long flexor tendons, nerve and vessels. Protect the underlying long flexor tendon, nerves and vessels. In fact, the nerves and vessels, you can see the nerves and vessels peep through the digital nerve and vessel, come out through the interval between the deep set of the longitudinal slips. You know, the base gives out 4 slips and each slip divide into superficial and deep set of fiber, that is the superficial set. Now between the deep set of the 4 slips, the digital nerves and vessel come out. Number 3 function, it provide origin to the palmaris brevis from the medial margin. And last but not the least, it provide the attachment of 3 palmar septi, medial, lateral and intermediate. What is the clinical importance? There is a term, it is called Dupuytren's contracture. Dupuytren's contracture. It is a progressive fibrosis in the medial part of the palmar aponeurosis. There is a progressive fibrosis. That means increase in the fibrous tissue in the medial part of the palmar aponeurosis. And as a result, the medial part of the aponeurosis may undergo progressive thickening to form a permanent contracture, resulting in flexion deformity of the little and ring fingers. So this medial part, it is fibrosed. As a result, thickened and contracted. If the medial part is contracted, it gets shortened and it pulls the little finger and the ring finger into flexion. That is called Dupuytren contracture. So when there is Dupuytren contracture, what will be the look of the hand? Suppose this is the hand, this is the thumb, index and middle finger. In Dupuytren contracture, the ring and little finger will be acutely flexed. So there will be flexion of little finger and ring finger respectively, because of the progressive fibrosis and thickening and contracture of the medial part. This part is fibrosed, thickened and contracted, and pull the medial 2 fingers, that is the little finger and ring finger, in acute flexion. That is called Dupuytren's contracture. the deep fascia on the front of each finger thickens to form the fibrous flexure sheath. So this colored structure over here represent the fibrous flexure sheath of the index finger. Before discussing further, we would like to discuss about the bony configuration underneath the fibrous flexure sheath. Bones in relation to the fibrous flexure sheath are as follows. This is the distal phalanx. Underneath it is the middle phalanx, proximal phalanx. This is the metacarpal. And the junctions are in between the metacarpal and proximal phalanx, that is the metacarpophalangeal joint, in between the proximal and middle phalanx, proximal interphalangeal joint, in between the middle phalanx and distal phalanx, distal interphalangeal joint. So these four bones, or rather three bones and part of the metacarpal, form three joint between them: metacarpophalangeal, proximal interphalangeal and distal interphalangeal. And the bones concerned are the distal phalanx, middle phalanx, proximal phalanx and the head of the metacarpals. Now, overlying these bones are the long flexor tendon. The tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis lying at a superficial plane and divides into two slips, which in turn is inserted on the side of the middle phalanx. So that is the tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis. And below the flexor digitorum superficialis and deep to it lies the tendon of flexor digitorum profundus. So flexor digitorum profundus runs below the flexor digitorum superficialis, in between the two slips of the flexor digitorum superficialis, and is ultimately inserted into the base of the distal phalanx. Okay, now both these tendons of flexor digitorum profundus and superficialis are covered by tubular synovial sheaths. Tubular synovial sheaths. Let me show you the synovial sheaths of this tendon. This is the synovial sheath, common for both the tendon. So let's draw a synovial sheath over them. So the synovial sheath will be covering the tendons, enveloping the tendons in a tubular fashion, and it will be like this. That is a synovial sheath. Covering all these things is the deep fascia of the finger, that is the fibrous flexure sheath. And this fibrous flexure sheath arches over the long flexor tendon along with their synovial sheath arches over them to form a tubular covering over the long flexor tendons and their synovial sheath. And is extended from the head of the metacarpal to the base of the distal phalanx. So that is the fibrous flexure sheath of the digit. So fibrous flexure sheath of the digit, it is an arched fibrous sheath. What is the term? Arched. Arched fibrous sheath. That is attached to the margin of the underlying bones and also to the margin of the intervening ligaments of the interphalangeal joint. And that is best appreciated when the diagram is seen from the side. See, this is the metacarpal, this is the head of metacarpal. This is the proximal phalanx, middle phalanx and distal phalanx. The fibrous flexure sheath is attached on the side of the phalangeal bones and arch over them to the opposite side. So they are actually covering not only the tendons but also they are covering synovial sheath. You see, this is the tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis. This is the tendon of flexor digitorum profundus underneath it. And both of them are covered by a tubular common synovial sheath. This synovial sheath containing both the tendons are in turn covered by this arched fibrous flexure sheath that is attached not only to the margin of the phalanges but also to the margin of the interphalangeal joint. Let me show you the interphalangeal joint. That is the proximal interphalangeal joint. That is the distal interphalangeal joint. And this one is the metacarpophalangeal joint. On the palmar aspect of all these joints are lying some fibrous structure. These are called the palmar ligaments or volar plates. What are these structures? Volar plates. Or palmar ligaments. In short, the fibrous flexure sheath is not only attached to the margin of the phalanx but also to the margin of the volar plates as well. Now, this fibrous flexure sheath has got two end, proximal end and the distal end. Proximal end and a distal end. Okay. So, let me show you. This is the proximal end of the fibrous flexure sheath. Obviously, the proximal end is open to admit the long flexor tendon within the synovial sheath, but the distal end, that is blind. So the sheath along with the anterior surface of the phalanges and the palmar ligaments of the interphalangeal and metacarpophalangeal joint, it will form a blind osteofibrous tunnel. So what will happen? The sheath is open proximally but closed distally, where it is attached to the base of the distal phalanx. Ultimately, this arched sheath along with the proximal surface of the underlying bone will form a osteofibrous tunnel through which the tendons are passing, and that is best appreciated on a cross section. So let's see the sectional view. This is the sectional view. Now where is the sheath? Let me draw the sheath. The sheath is extending like this. Arched sheath. So it is converting the whole aspect into a blind osteofibrous tunnel. Okay. Through the tunnel, what is transmitted? The tendons along with their synovial sheaths. They are transmitted through this osteofibrous tunnel. Okay. Now, the important thing is that in case of the medial forefingers, this osteofibrous tunnel, obviously this is forming a tunnel. Like this. In case of index finger, middle finger, ring finger and little finger, this tunnel transmits the flexor digitorum superficialis and flexor digitorum profundus. But for the thumb, this tunnel only transmit one tendon, and that tendon belong to flexor pollicis longus. Coming to the further fine structure of the fibrous flexor sheath, we can see that the fibrous flexor sheath is arranged as annular and cruciform parts. In the annular parts, the fibers are ring-like, arched, but the cruciform fibers are intervening between them and they are actually crossing over like a cross, hence called cruciform. So two part, annular and cruciform. The fibrous sheath is thick over the phalanges and it is thin over the interphalangeal joint. Over the joints, it is thin in order to permit flexion of the joints. So thick over the bones, thin over the joints. The fibrous flexor sheath hold the tendons in position during the flexion of digits. There is a clinical condition that is called trigger finger. You have to know this term, trigger finger. What happens during the trigger finger? It is a clinical condition in which the finger gets locked in full flexion and can be extended only after excessive voluntary effort or with the help of other hand. This condition is caused by a localized thickening of a long flexor tendon. So what happens is that localized thickening, suppose there is a localized thickening over the tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis. So that thickening will prevent the tendon glide smoothly under the cover of the fibrous flexor sheath. And if the swelling is sufficiently larger, that will imply that whenever the tendon will try to move, the thickened part will be caught in the osteofibrous tunnel, right? So suppose this is the osteofibrous tunnel, this is the fibrous flexor sheath. Now the tendon has got a swelling, so that swelling prevents the free movement of the tendon, and whenever the tendon try to move along the osteofibrous tunnel, the thickened part is caught momentarily. Okay, and the movement can only occur only after excessive voluntary effort or with the help of other hand, and it occurs suddenly with a click sound, hence the name trigger finger. This condition can be relieved surgically by incising, by cutting. If you cut it, if this structure is cut, fibrous flexor sheath is cut open. So here you can see that is the fibrous flexor sheath, and here the fibrous flexor sheath has been cut open, and what you see in the tube, that you see it is the synovial sheath. When the synovial sheath is also cut, we can get to see the tendons. So we have to remember that inside the fibrous flexor sheath, inside the fibrous flexor sheath, there will be the synovial sheath. Synovial sheath. Inside the synovial sheath, we get the tendon. So inside the fibrous flexor sheath, there is the synovial sheath, and inside the synovial sheath, there is the tendon. So that is all about the fibrous flexor sheath of the digits.